we're back on the road. We're going to Aberdeen for the first visit to WrestleZone in this season for Battle of the Nations. I'm in the car. I am looking at the nice countryside. We've just passed a really big manure patch. It stunk. But yes, Battle of the Nations is happening. It's show three of the season. The first one just went out as of recording. It's got a good few numbers. Weirdly, a short went out of Taylor Bryden getting kicked in the nuts by Luke King Sharp, and it's got great numbers. 2.3 thousand as of this recording have watched Luke King Sharp kick Taylor Bryden in the nutsack. And if that's not what the internet is for, I don't know what is. But we've got a good show on tonight for Battle of the Nations, which we'll probably do some little bits when we get to Aberdeen. Probably won't. We might do. But we're going to go up there. We're staying at the station hotel itself, so it's a nice commute down the stairs, I think. We don't know. I've never actually stayed at the station hotel. Go past all the riffraff that are in the queue, and go straight into the show itself. For VIP, we've double-checked, I've triple-checked, and we definitely have tickets. Of one year I got paranoid, and I didn't actually have tickets for Avenue Anarchy, and I'm still a little bit scared ever since that I forgot to buy tickets. I am joined by Kelly. She may jump in, she may not. It's up to her. But at the moment, you're stuck with my voice, because I'm going to talk about Battle of Nations, and I can't wait for it. There's six matches, VIP, and it's a packed show. It's they come down from Avenue Anarchy. Avenue Anarchy was a huge show, huge event. If you've seen the Road Trip episode, because of that, there was a little bit of awkward silence in the car after the main event, because I was right, and I always like being right. It's a very rarity for me, especially when it comes to WrestleZone itself. But with six matches and pre-show to go down, let's run down the card. We've got the VIP first up, six-person tag team match. We've got Oliver Green. I forgot the match. Oliver Green, Tommy Raiden, and Air Miles against the Outfit. That's Dino Murphy and Ted O'Keefe, which should be a lot of fun. It'll be weird in the station hotel itself, because there is a very low ring, very limited space either side of the actual ring itself, and there's like no seating on two of the sides. So for one side, and I'm really hoping that it's not our side, we'll have Dino Murphy at some point standing at the corner. So we only may see like two-thirds of the match itself, because they're big lads and they will take up quite a bit of space. I mean, if Ted's there, it's fine, we'll just see over his head. But so we'll get to see a lot of the match itself.
I feel sorry for Ted.
No, you don't.
You're vertically challenged too.
Me and Ted are pals now.
You
were there at Aberdeen Anarchy. You said we're friends.
Okay.
It hasn't stopped me taking the piss out of him. But if anything, it's made it more so. I've taken the piss out of him more because of it. It's like, you give me permission now, I will just do it. And I have nothing against you, Ted, personally. Or professionally. He had a really good match. Still bugs me a little bit that he had a really good match at Aberdeen Anarchy. Anyway. It's a really good match. I think this will be fun. Like I say, it's going to be quite tight. So, and it's got a low ceiling as well. So Tommy Raiden might not have a lot of aerial space. Acrobatics space. Yep. Oliver Green, this will be he's still had a good handful of matches. Just had a really good chat with him last week, I think it was, for the podcast. Really nice guy, and it's really good to see an Elgin boy do good, yeah, from Elgin. Mm-hmm. Originally, there you go. It's weird, there's a lot of wrestlers that seem to be like they've lived in Elgin at some point and they've left. I don't know what that says about Elgin itself.
Says what needs to be said about Elgin.
we're claiming Oliver, we're claiming Ian Skinner. We've still got Mayhem Brooks, so we're building a little Elgin faction eventually. We'll find some more as we go along. So we've got that. Any thoughts on the six man? Are you just happy to be there?
Just happy to be there.
Excellent.
I'll probably still be in a car and just cold enough for more pizza.
Oh, yeah. And also, we may have a drink.
We may have a
couple
we're
drinks.
We're three tonight.
We're staying in Aberdeen. And then this will be the awkward bit. There'll be the montage. And then there'll be the bit where
drive it home at like ridiculous o'clock in the morning. And you shush your face at Tom Tom. So yeah, we've got the 6-man tag. Look forward to that. So on to the main card itself. There's loads of matches. Ross play a lot of story going into it. A lot of it seems to be fallout from Aberdeen Anarchy. Some of it's just general fallout from the start of the year from Station Hotel. Last time we were at Station Hotel. So we'll start off with Deacon Matthews, Captain Alan Sterling, because it's one of the matches that doesn't have a stipulation on it. I think this will be good bit of entertainment. Deacon Matthews is the cult of positivity. He's dancing, he likes to do a little bit of dancing, jumping and jiving, which will anger our fair captain, Captain Alan.
Toot toot.
And they seem to go back and forth with some poetry on the interweb.
Okay.
I know, that's it. Deacon Matthews did a sea shanty.
What did he?
He did a sea shanty. It was very interesting, and I wish they had a second take of it because he ran out of breath during it. And then there was a big, and then he carried on. I was like, he could probably did two takes of that, to be honest. But he had that. Yeah, it's just, it's Captain Alan. It's going to be a good laugh. He beat Evan Young at Aberdeen Anarchy. Which was nice to see Evan. He's not on the show. But it was nice to see Evan again. Even if it was briefly. But yeah, this is just going to be a riot. There's going to be a few matches on the show tonight. There's just going to be a good bit of just good laugh. For some reason or another. So, any prediction?
No.
Okay. I'm just going to go Captain Alan.
I'm just going to let what happens. What will be.
You're going to just enjoy yourself. You're gonna have a couple cocktails at Pizza Hut and you're just gonna enjoy what happens in front of you.
I'm looking forward to the child free night.
Well, no, you've got the big kid here. He's gonna be giving you about the rest.
Well, there is that point, but you sleep through the night, so.
Yes, I do, and well, I'll have a couple of drinks. You won't be, because I'll be snoring.
Oh, no.
Yay! So, what else we got? We've got the blindfold match, which I think you're very curious about.
I just think that that's an absolute way to happen. And after what happened in the last show, I'm a bit scared.
So a Damien versus Ronan King blindfold match. We've got eye patch Damien though, which is all I wanted after he got stabbed in the eye from a...
He shouldn't have been stabbed in the eye.
I know, but...
We shouldn't be at this point. I just don't understand how a blindfold match is supposed to work. But surely they need to see each other to beat each other to a pulp.
Right,
I don't get it.
Off camera, I will tell you the secrets of how a blindfold match works.
I'm guessing that there are secrets. Probably.
But for the case of this, it's going to be a lot of fan interaction. So yeah. I'm going to save the voice, have it all lubricated. By alcohols or what have you, just so you're ready to cheer for Damien pointing to places and you cheating when he points at Ronan, and then you not cheering or booing when Ronan does the same. That's the plan. That's the general plan. But you know, Ronan's gonna have a trick up his sleeve. He's gonna he doesn't wear sleeves because his mum's jacket doesn't have sleeves. But if he'll have a plan. Unfortunately, probably involving Dennis. I bet Dennis is going to referee this match. If Dennis is refereeing this match, all bets are off. Ronan's going to cheat.
Who's actually wearing the blindfold?
Exactly. Dennis doesn't know the law.
That's
As the podcasts go, the meaner I get about Dennis.
Dennis doesn't know the law.
That's what I said. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Sorry, I'm just getting your joke. I'm a bit slow today.
we've had half a monster.
What? Jesus Christ. Sorry. Behind this car and it's just not being very...
It's a BMW. Driver. It should really, like...
I'm surprised it's got indicators, to be fair.
Well, hang on, let's have a look. Old person! Whey! Right, what else have we got? So that was... two matches, so I've got four more to remember. We have the handicap match. Who has the handicap? It's Mr. Omar Mohammed and Mr. WrestleZone against Brian Tucker with Rhys Dawkins in his corner. So last time at Station Hotel, it was Mr. Omar. Mr. WrestleZone wasn't even a thing at that point.
or was it? Omar Mohammed was against Reese and Brian in last Imitation Hotel. This time the turns have tabled and it's a handicap match.
Michael Scott.
Mr. Omar and Mr. WrestleZone against Brian Wally Tucker in a handicap match. Again, this would be much like the Deacon Campbell match. This is just going to be a bit of fun, a bit of jollies. This will probably be slotted in between the two the title matches, maybe.
But you know what the real question needs to be asked is?
Yes.
Will Scotty be there?
Oh, well. He said he won't come back to shows after last time at Station Hotel when he got into a bit of a scrap with Brian. So will Scotty be there? Does Scotty know? Scotty doesn't know.
Don't start that. So, we need to be doing that on the podcast.
So we still don't know who Mr. WrestleZone is. There's the theories. The theory of it being Jonathan Geddes was punted out of the stratosphere at Abu Dhabi. So we still don't know. Is it Sean Johnson? We haven't seen Sean Johnson since Christmas Chaos.
Mr.
P's come back, so hopefully we'll see Mr. P. Mr. P. The judge, jury, and executioner of WrestleZone.
Super executioner.
Super executioner.
I still don't think he's real.
We may never know now. I don't know. I hope Mr. P. When you come back to when WrestleZone comes back to Keith or comes to a show near us. We need a super executioner. Find him. You know where he is.
Just abandon all your principles and come to Elgin. Please.
Come to Elgin.
We want to take our child to WrestleZone.
WrestleZone is where he's going to pop his wrestling cherry. So it needs to be WrestleZone. It needs to be nearby.
It's too close.
We're still a bit fair to take him far. So after that, any prediction for the handicap match? Brian's going to find a way, isn't he?
Brian's probably going to find a way.
Reese is going to be there with his big Shakespearean book.
His dictionary.
With a K.
Burn!
I'm excited.
I know, I can tell.
Right, what else have we got? So we've got title matches. I'll leave the one that I think you'll be most excited for Ultimate Label. We'll go for the tag team titles next. Your favourite tag team, the Foundation of the Future, Bruiser Brad Evans and Ryan Riley, taking on the team of Conor Malloy and Bingo Balance. So last time,
the Future's going to win that match.
I think the Foundation will win, but I think it was going to be a good competition. Conor, last time we saw him at Station Hotel, he had that amazing match with Caleb, which wasn't even advertised. It had to be moved about a bit, and it was fantastic. And then he had he won the ladder match. A ladder match that you liked, which is incredible in itself for someone who doesn't like ladder matches, because you find them pointless. Or
I folded like a step stool, didn't I?
You find them stupid as a concept.
Never mind.
You don't like watching crawling up the ladders, which is understandable. It's fine. So he's got that title opportunity in his back pocket, so he could win this title and then still have that title opportunity in his back pocket. So he's got nothing to lose in this match, is Conor Malloy. Everything to gain. And we get to see Bingo back. We haven't seen Bingo since Halloween Hijinks. It was the first show back after 2 years. So we get to see Bingo again. I always hope he's wearing his Iron Brew gear because it's the coolest. The blue and orange. Yes, I suppose. Yeah. I don't know what side of Ireland is on, so I don't know if that's good or bad. So I love his Iron Brew gear anyway. But if not, it's good to see Bingo back. And plus, because we've watched Bluey that much since the arrival of Jack.
Bingo.
But yeah, that's pretty much all it's going to be. When he comes out, he'll be like, Conor! Bingo! No, just me? Okay, cool.
Just you.
So we've got that. Yeah, I think the Foundation's going to win. I think it's going to be quite academic. But, you never know. Could be a wee surprise.
Could be.
We've got the Tri-Couch Championship match, which I think is the one you're going to be most
most excited for. Mm-hmm. We have Zach Dynamite defending against the mighty Caleb Valhalla. No, I'm loving it. with the mighty Caleb Valhalla, I'm wearing my Caleb / Aspen t-shirt, so it just saves
Stole
me.
Stole my shirt!
So, we bought two, so I can support both in this event. As I say always, I love Zach Dynamite, and then between the hours of 6 o'clock to about 10 once a month, I hate him, so I'll be hoping Caleb will win. Of course, Caleb needs to get some gold in WrestleZone.
Absolutely.
He's been champ. He's current champion down in Fair City, heavyweight champion there. He needs some gold.
I want him to win.
I always want him to win. So we'll be rooting for Caleb. I think it's going to be really good, though. It's going to be a really good match.
Yeah.
Zach is just having. I've put it in our little five matches to watch this weekend because there's like five shows.
He's having a really good season.
Season of his wrestling career at the moment. He's having just amazing matches with everyone. There's a match that's went online with him and Emerson Jane, and it's phenomenal. They've had a little tussle in Discovery at the moment as well. Cool. Zach's just operating on some extra level of wrestling right now. I think him and Caleb, because Caleb, like I mentioned with Connor, him and Connor had an amazing match last time at Station Hotel. He's coming off a tough loss to Aspen at Aberdeenagh, which was close. He could have been champion that night if it was a different night, but it wasn't, and I made sure I was right. I have to. It's so rare that I get a prediction right in WrestleZone. So rare. I've got to keep it going. Rumble seems to be the only one I can kind of get it, and everything else, just I lose. So we've got that.
But you're the first person off your seat celebrating Caleb
in
the Rumble, weren't you? No,
I was not. That was definitely you. I've never seen you move so fast. And it's amazing. I do enjoy watching you just enjoy yourself with the wrestling. It's great. Because I've been watching it for 30 years, so I'm a bit like, oh. Sometimes my brain goes, this is the most amazing thing, and the other part of me goes, oh, that's correct booking. I try and get rid of that bit. That bit can go away. The logical one going, of course they've won. This is the way it's going to go next. No, stop that. Enjoy the wrestling. So we're just about into Aberdeen, so let's just get the main event in, and then we can actually go and enjoy ourselves, and we'll get pissed. Well, the main event is an interesting one, I think. It's Zach. No, it's not. That's not the main event. Might be. It's Mickey Vago. He'll be in the main event with Lost Boy Aspen over the Undisputed WrestleZone Championship.
Go Vago!
Yeah. It's because he beat.
I'm just trying to get back in his good books.
Yes. Oh, yeah. Because Kelly thinks she's in Vago's bag books for supporting Archer.
I'm not saying I support Archer.
I understand
where he was coming from, and I think that Vago had that coming, but that's not to say that I'm not on Vago's team, because I very much like Vago too. I'm digging.
I'm going to be supporting Aspen. That goes without saying. Everyone knows that. I think if Vago's listening to this and I say otherwise, he'll be like, he's lying. But I think this could be interesting. I think it's quite an underrated match because this is two good guys. Even though Aspen has done no change in character, as in he came back, when he was away, he was the bad guy. Mm-hmm. And then he came back and he's changed nothing in terms of how he interacts with the crowd.
His perception, people's perception of him has changed.
Yeah, he's like
what makes the difference.
He's the boy that's done good. He went away from WrestleZone, did all this. Yeah, local boy done good, and he's come back and everyone loves Aspen. And like I say, he maybe do one high five or maybe a fist bump to the crowd. That's about it. He's still the same Aspen otherwise.
I like them both. I don't care who wins, to be honest. In the main event,
I wouldn't be upset if Vago won. I know that's a lie, I would be.
Stop lying yourself.
If Vago won,
I would be interested to hear what Kyle and Kaylee think. Because there's a split in that household.
Oh yes, it's your turn, guys. We had it at Anarchy. It's your turn with Kaylee being the Mickey Vago super fan and Kyle being the pre-evolution of Aspen. That's a Pokemon reference.
Okay.
I'm glad Kelly's not on camera because she just, you know what, that hurt me a little bit. That look.
I have no clue what you're talking about.
It was a disappointment. It was the look of, God, you're such a nerd kind of look.
You are a nerd.
So yeah.
I don't know what you mean to say.
I know. But yeah, so I think it's, like I say, I'll be upset if Aspen loses, but if Vago won up, there will be a part of me that's like, yeah, Vago's done all the work. He's in tremendous shape. He's done the work. He won the Tri-Counties Championship. He had a really fun match at Anarchy. He's put in the work to be heavyweight champion. But I want Aspen to hold the belt forever. So that's
just not realistic.
That's just the way the cookie crumbles.
It's not realistic. Somebody can't hold on to the second belt forever. Otherwise, there would be no point in having shows. So he's got to lose it at some point.
But no.
That's the whole point of your wrestling. That's the whole point. If somebody keeps on a hold of the belt forever, then there is no point in a show.
You know what? The weirdest thing is though. That is very a really good point about the current state of WWE wrestling, because Roman Reigns has been champion for 3 years. So that's
it's pointless.
That's a really, really interesting point you've brought up on this podcast without you even meaning to. So there we go, there's that. And with that, we've previewed the show. I think Dynamite Valhalla is going to be probably the match of the night. It's one that we're going to be like, that was amazing. The blindfold match, I am so intrigued what your thoughts are afterwards, because you've never seen one. And ironically, you've never seen a blindfold match. I know. I'm so predictable. So yeah, I think it's going to be a really fun show.
Sorry, guys, F-bomb.
I know. I was trying really hard not to swear for once, but we're sitting at the same time.
There's no child in the car. Exactly.
We're child free. Right.
It's been a whole year, guys.
So next up will be the little bit I do, the wee video of the ring and then the montage. We might have some thoughts in the hotel room afterwards. If not, we've got drunk and you might see me horrifically hungover next. So that'll be fun.
I will not be on camera if that's the case.
So put your monster up, Ultra Rosa, with a clink. That was awful from us there.
I was looking
at my face, which, who's the narcissist here in this? Let's do it, right? Montage next. Everyone has a good time. I don't know why I'm doing that. Hello. I'm here. Before we get the montage going, where's my camera? Hello. Before we get the montage going, just got to let you know that thanks to Kirsten and Louise Photography. We've got some of our photos in the montage, which I'm glad that we got to a little bit of collaboration. You can find out about Kirsten and Louise Photography more on Instagram, Facebook. Just go search Kirsten and Louise Photography and you'll find out everything. She just became a fan of WrestleZone this year, thanks to, I think, Comic-Con towards the end of last year or this year. I don't know. The timeline is wibbly-wobbly. But passionate fan, takes great photos. They're the ones that are going to be in black and white, all artistic. That was an artistic choice by the editor, me. So go check it out. Go check out Kirsten Louise and enjoy the montage.
Times like all you want to do is run.
Right, we're finally doing the outro. It is now Thursday as we...
It's Thursday
as we record. It has been a hell of a week for one reason or another. It is roasting here as well, so I'm sitting here in shorts. It is so hot. It's not built for me. This my body is not ready for this kind of heat. You think I'm used to it by now, because last year was a heat wave as well. That's not what you're here for. This is for the outro to our episode. Hope you enjoyed the montage that just happened. I really enjoyed the montage. Kelly's not seen the montage.
You've
probably never seen the montage.
Probably not.
No. But it was nice. It was nice to have a wee collaboration. I put some photos and videos of myself that I took, and some photos that Kirsten took as well, to make a wee collaboration
Kirsten's
effort.
Kirsten's photos are fantastic.
So she's really happy with them because of the lighting.
Yeah, but they're still fantastic. Mm-hmm. So shout out to Kirsten.
So there's some really good ones in there. But this is, to be honest, I've written about this show now. I did the recap, the WrestleZone recap. So nobody's really wanted to hear my opinion about the show. They want to hear Kelly's opinion about the show. And I think we're going to go match by match for your kind of thoughts. I'll throw in some thoughts as well, because I've only properly done my thoughts through a written medium. Finishing at 11:30 at night, and I only needed to edit two things, which was incredible because I did it all on my phone. So the first match of the show, let's talk about going to the Station Hotel. This is your second trip to the Station Hotel.
Yeah.
And we actually stayed at the Station Hotel this time.
We did.
And the rooms are humongous.
Our room was directly above the function suite that Battle of Nations was in. So we could hear the music as they were setting up the ring. That was pretty cool.
I know, we went past and we came downstairs and we went, oh, someone must be odd in there. Because hadn't really registered. hadn't really registered, that's where it was. Because I couldn't remember where we went last time.
No, me neither.
Because I thought I was being great cocky. It was downstairs as the doors
were closed. I was remembering where SummerSlam was the year that we went to the Best Western.
Oh, Summer Hill.
Summer Hill Showdown, sorry.
It's all right.
Summer Hill Showdown. I was remembering that one. That was the one where your picture was on the wall, wasn't it?
Sorry. Yes, that was the one where... That was the one where Mickey Vago banned me from the show.
Yeah. That's the one that's the location of the function suite where I was remembering.
Mm-hmm.
But obviously I knew where the Station Hotel was. I was pleasantly surprised by the Station Hotel's bedroom.
It was higher ceiling than the ballroom did.
Felt like it, yeah. But we didn't have a ring
reckon you could have fit a ring in there and got...
Anyway.
Maybe not have the coffee desk. Anyway, yeah.
That's not the point.
Absolutely.
The point is, it was a nice hotel,
mm-hmm.
and it was really handy that we were staying where the event was, because we could have some alcohol
yes.
on Saturday night, and it was our first night away from Jack, and it was very enjoyable.
Yeah, because we got pissed in the first half and had to try and sober ourselves up for the second.
Yeah, because we were giggling like school kids.
Shouting away. So the show itself, we got in, got out, all good. Our food was running, our meal ran late, so we were just running over and trying to get changed and ready so we could go downstairs or go wherever to actually get into the show. We got in, second row seats, nice, hard, opposite the hard cam. So that means that when it goes out on DVD, the likelihood is people will see you jumping up when certain match happened.
Yeah.
Finished.
Mm-hmm.
I think makes up for a lot, because last time you did this with me, it was Army Anarchy, and I was incredibly smug. And,
yes, you were.
And it's made up for it, I think. Although I was very happy, but still. So, the match itself, the show started pre-show, six-man tag, outfit against Oliver Green, Tommy Raiden, and Air Miles. Outfit uh-huh. picked up the win quite comprehensively.
But cheating.
Did they?
No, sorry, I'm mixing up my matches.
Ted won't like that. Ted won't like this besmirchment.
I'm really sorry. Really sorry, Ted. If it helps, I'm shorter than you. I can't remember much.
Pretty much they just dominated it. They
were very good, I have to say. They were good. You know, they were good at riling the crowd up, getting everybody ready for the main show.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a good match.
Yeah.
It was a good match.
I said, there wasn't a lot to it for...
I don't have technical...
That's okay.
...construct a criticism to provide. That's Billy's job.
Yeah. Well,
my job is just to stay off camera because... And give my opinion.
That's what you're here for. That's what people are listening to this bit for. Like I said, I've written about it enough and did the recap and all that kind of stuff. So people are here for your opinion. I've just noticed how fat I've made my chin when I put the camera. So I'm just going to move that up a little bit.
Below makes chins.
Well, some of the road trip episodes I've had to put into the where the gearbox, the gear stick is in the car.
Oh.
It is not a very pretty sight for me.
I'm sure.
It's really not. So the six-man tag... Very dominated, great showcase for the outfit. We've got to see what they can do a bit more because it's the first, I think it was maybe the first time as a trio that we've got to see them all in action. And it was
that Summer Hill showdown where I in particular last saw Ted properly because he came back for Anarchy, but he wasn't really back.
He appeared at the Rumble, and then, Anarchy had that match with Oliver Green, which was really good.
So it seems like he's taken some time away, and he's come back better and stronger.
Mm-hmm.
Hopefully, we'll just see him progress.
Yeah, who knows? Maybe we're going to be best friends.
Nice to see an Elgin lad in the ring, though. Oliver Green.
Oliver Green, he found out that he's an Elgin boy.
Yeah.
I think he was born in Elgin and he went down south, but it's fine. It still counts.
He's still one of ours. We're still like Kevin McKidd. Kevin McKidd's still from Elgin.
Mm-hmm.
Even though he's in Grey's Anatomy and all that stuff, he's still from here.
Yeah, so we're gathering more Elgin folk because it was to go along in this, yeah. Even though I'm technically not. I've lived here long enough.
I'm a Rhodesian.
So yeah, six-man tag, great stuff. Really, really good match that set the tone for... It was great to see outfit showcase for the next match on the main show, which was Bruiser Brad Evans and Ryan Riley defending and successfully retaining tag team titles against Conor Malloy and Bingo Balance.
It was them that cheated.
I can't remember if they did.
Yeah, they cheated because they had Brad distract...
Oh, right, okay, right. Yes, I can't remember who the ref was. I've definitely got pictures. I'll assume it's Dennis.
Ryan just made it look like he had gotten a pin when actually somebody was passed out. And again, the nitty gritty details are somewhat hazy.
We were on a couple beer/ciders at that point, yeah. So we know.
It was a child-free night, so forgive our memory. And we're talking like nearly a week ago now. Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah.
It's like 5 nights ago.
Yeah. So, yeah, so, they used the number of advantage from what I remember. So, they took out Bingo and then they double-teamed Connor.
It's a shame we were in a venue with such a low ceiling because we didn't get to see Bingo at his best because Bingo's really good with the flips and the acrobatic stuff, and he couldn't do that in there because he would have knocked himself out quite easily.
And same with Connor as well.
Same with Connor. Ryan's really tall, you know. Myself and Ted probably wouldn't have that problem. But tall people and a shorter ring, and it's just an absolute meeting to
have. I did enjoy your ooze every time that Ryan picked up Connor or something, and you were like, oh, like, Ryan, remember your height, kind of thing, and dunked off like the top.
I could just see somebody's head going through that ceiling. It was just, it's a great venue. It's maybe a bit too low.
Too snug for the tall people.
Yes.
What was the match after that? It was Captain Allen and Deacon Matthews.
Yes, it was. That was a good match.
Yeah, we were.
I particularly liked the dance off.
Yeah.
But then that wasn't really wrestling, was it?
It's all part of the entertainment package. So Captain Allen and Deacon Matthews, the winner was Captain Allen. With from what I remember, it was his.
Allen's comedy is just spot on.
I wrote in the review, and I was so happy. I pointed out to you when it happened, is he came out with his captain uniform, which he ironed the top, didn't iron the bottom. But he'd come with his captain
and
hat.
And he took the captain hat off, and he had his sailor hat on underneath.
He put his battle cap on, that was his battle hat on for the match, and I was like...
That was freaking funny.
And there was like little bits where he mocked Deacon for wearing trunks with smiley faces on it, like he wasn't wearing a t-shirt with his face on it.
All over the face.
Because it's all about the Allen. That was,
but no one's allowed to do that except Allen, are they? So
it was such a good, it was such an entertaining match. It was just fun. It was a bit of hilarity. Oh, we haven't even mentioned the bit before that. Afterwards, Ryan and got on the microphone and was run down all the tag teams, and then got to the outfit. The outfit came out, all three of them, and I was standing there going, "Oh my god, I'm gonna have to cheer for the outfit. I don't like this prospect." Came out and ran them out. So that's the big setup for the rest of the year. I think we're going to see the outfit and the foundation in the future, which followed on another moment of the show, which we'll get to. So we'll probably shoot that then. Anyway,
we're flippy flopping.
Flippy flopping. It's okay. It's cool. That's how we remember. Like I say, it is Thursday.
Yeah.
So dance off, some silliness, all good, all fun. Captain Allen, Deacon Matthews. Would you want to see Deacon back up again?
Yeah. That's the second time we've seen him. I've seen him.
Yes.
And yeah, I like him. I think he's funny. I think he warms up. Like, if the crowd is could be getting a bit lackluster by that point, he rallies them up again. It was a bit.
It's Panto.
It's a bit like Grado. You know what I mean? He's. I don't want to call him a ripoff, but it's this. It's a similar entrance. Dancing along to something, some sort of classic song that everybody knows.
Yeah.
And I like that. I like that as part of the show because I'm a big music fan.
Yeah, but you wouldn't want it all the show, but it's nice to have that little bit of levity.
Yeah, it's just, it was nice to just, although there was a bit of a technical issue during that match.
Yes.
That kind of gave away... to the train die, what was possibly going to happen in the match.
Yes, and it was after the dance-off portion, it was using Deacon Matthew's music. Alan's music played for a split second, which Captain Allen was hilarious, because he jumped out and went, "Yay!" after it happened. Yeah. Like, it was all meant to happen, but then Allen won, and you're like, "Ah, okay, that was probably why."
So it was a good match. I enjoyed it. Don't know if I wanted Allen to win, but I don't know if I wanted Deacon to win either. So I was happy with the outcome.
Your butt's got splinters because you're on the fence.
Yeah, I am.
But Allen's picking up wins. He's picking up a lot of wins, and he appeared later on in the show as well. First half main event was the blindfold match.
That was amazing. I've never seen a blindfold match before. And
I got to use my Damien joke in my write-up, so don't worry, I won't do it again.
I really, really enjoyed it. It was funny. It was all new for me, but I really enjoyed it, and I really I think that Damien deserved the win.
I got stabbed last time, so
yeah. You know. The only way is up.
That was the first time. Well, I can't remember seeing a blindfold match in person. There's been one or two in WrestleZone in the past. I've seen a couple on like WWE and all that kind of stuff. But so I knew the kind of concept of it was going to be cheer for the good guy,
boo the bad guy.
Don't cheer. Don't let him know where Damien is. Yeah. And they did a lot of like sound moments with Damien stamping on the mat and Ronan. At one point, Rowan did a frog splash to nothing.
It was fab.
It was just so clever. It was just, and it didn't give away the magic because No, I'm old enough now to know how the kind of blindfold matches work. But
I think, everyone.
I don't think it gave away the magic of it. They did the job well.
I don't think you'd have known.
Mm-hmm.
If you hadn't told me, I wouldn't have known.
So I'm the arsehole here.
You're a spoiler.
I'm an Extractor fan. Ronan took off his mask during the match, as expected.
Uh-huh. Fully expected him to do it. In fact, I'm surprised he didn't do it sooner in the match. So, yeah, I mean, he's a dirty dot and cheat. But he still lost. So
exactly. So it all kind of worked, came out in the wash, it worked out.
And you win, fair enough. But if you cheat and you lose, then you're the loser, aren't you?
Yeah. But it looks like this has been parked for a moment, Ronan and Damien. I don't know if there's going to be another match.
Be another match.
I'm hoping so, because I still want to see Summer Battle Run.
Although, after the match,
yes,
Mr. Captain Allen appeared on the screen, didn't he?
He did, and he pointed because out he that
pointed
Damien
out the fact that Damien looks like a pirate just now with his eye patch. So he has to defend the seas. So I think that's what's going to be happening at Halloween Hijinks, isn't it?
I think so. I just loved it when it happened. Damien just was like, oh, come on, no. Like,
I can't wait to see him dressed as a pirate, because he's going to be this like emo, punky pirate. He's going to look so cool.
Hello, Sandy.
Hi, Sandy.
I wasn't sure. I was thinking pirate. I always have, because he's got the eye patch now and he's all like brooding. I don't know if you've ever seen Metal Gear Solid. You know, that kind of...
Yeah.
No. That's my kind of idea, like all stealthy and that, and yeah, Google it. But yeah, so Captain Allen was on the screen and said that, yeah, pretty much that Damien's a pirate and he needs to rid WrestleZone of pirates because he's a captain, and that's what captains do. And
that's kind of how I pictured him.
Yeah, with the headband and. And it doesn't sound so cool when I say it like that. But
this guy.
Emo pirate.
Emo pirate.
So that was set up for a lot. There was a lot of Halloween hijinks set up between the...
Well, of course there was. It's the next event, isn't it?
Yeah, well, Inverurie's first, but Inverurie's can do a little stopover to the next big one.
Yeah, so it's their next big event. Yeah. So of course there was. You don't prepare for Christmas by not putting up your Christmas tree. It's... You have to lay the groundwork.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So that was first half. We'd had at that point maybe just a few drinks from the day when we got there. Oh, yeah, so we realised we needed probably an iron brew or that just to kind of...
Yeah.
Kind of...
Which I think was our downfall. Anyway, carry on. So that was the first half main event.
It was excellent. It was such a good match. And I like that now that it seems to be when we're coming to shows, if there's a big like kind of gimmick match that you're not sure, like the ladder match, I still can't believe the ladder match was your favourite match at Anarchy, because it was like you came in going, I don't like ladder matches. They're boring. They don't make sense. They're just rubbish. And then afterwards you're like, yeah, it was my favourite match of the show. And now we've got the same with the blindfold match, as you came in not sure what to expect, and it was an absolute riot from start to finish.
Everyone loves a gimmick.
Yeah, I still, I want to see Summer get some digs into Ronan. That's what I want to see.
Summer.
Damien's daughter.
Oh, yeah.
I want to see that.
Absolutely.
And I think it would be great if they're not prolonging the story any further, is if Ronan still is blindfold on after the match ended. And
we don't know what he's going to look like at hijinks.
True. But if she came into the ring while he still had the blindfold on and just leathered him, so he didn't see it coming, ironically, because Damien got his eye stabbed. So it's that would be cool to see, but I still enjoyed what I saw.
Yeah.
Same thing. So interval happened. Not much happened. Like I say, we were just trying to sober up at that point.
Oh, big thanks to Mr. P.
Oh, yes, Mr.
For
P.
For sorting out the camera guy, because being the short person that I am, I was not happy to be stuck behind the tall cameraman. So big thanks to Mr. P for sorting that out for us.
Yes, you tweeted WrestleZone directly.
I did.
Asking them if they could please please move the cameraman to the other side, which had no fans. You weren't like going, no, put them next to the other people.
No.
But moved to this people. There was a side that had the little canteen area.
The bar. Dude.
I'm tired. So yeah, that's where he was moved to. Thankfully, we saw Mr. P just come up to him and go, just shifted him along, mm-hmm. and that was it. Nothing, no harm, no foul. There was no shouting or caroming. It was just a simple request, and it was sorted. Mr. P did the job as management representative. He judged, juried, and executed the plan. So back for the break. It was your favorite match of the night. Because it was the Tri-County Championship match.
This was my favourite match, right?
Big, stupid, sexy Caleb came out in his cape. And
stupid belt-winning Caleb.
Oh, spoilers. He came out with his big cape.
Everybody knows if it was my favourite match of the night.
And you got to actually see it more up close and personal. I didn't really, because we were a little bit further back for Anarchy. So it's still a very cool cape.
Yeah.
It's very cool.
I do like the cape.
The cape's cool.
As well. I just like the whole Viking thing. But did you notice that there was a couple behind us drinking from a horn?
No, I didn't.
During his match. Yeah, they were proper drinking skull.
Yeah.
That's
commitment.
A horn. Yeah. So
They were horny for Caleb.
Oh, that's enough. it was a good match. There was a lot of almost moments. And it was quite stressful.
So that's the Regal Rumble.
We got there in the end. He's got the Rumble, mm-hmm. and he's got the belt. Now all he needs is Anarchy.
He needs to get back to Anarchy, back to the main event, back to win the Undisputed title. So that's three very stressful.
He has to match Aspen's.
Oh, I saw him wear a tag title. So, you know, maybe. Are you volunteering?
No.
He just stand in the corner. He could deal. He threw Brad and Ryan over the top rope at Regal Rumble. Surely he could beat them by himself. And then...
I'd be more useless than Brian Tucker.
Brian Tucker got a win.
I know.
Which we're all shocked about. We are definitely flippy flopping. So, the match itself, incredible. There was a lot of big moments. There was. Because it's a lower ring, I think it afforded them a little bit more high risk for things like Caleb's big spear to the outside when he speared Zach from the ring off the apron. And no, I was worried about, because when I was at the bar, I noticed that some of the tiles cracked. And I was just, when that happened, my overriding moment was going, ooh, watch out, the tiles are cracked. Like, I'm a dad. I'm just like watching it going, oh,
you're gonna hurt yourself.
You're gonna hurt yourself. Not that they're flinging each other about for the last whatever minutes, including a snapdragon suplex right in front of us on the wooden floor.
Yeah, that was
that left a big sweaty mark.
Big sweaty Caleb mark.
So I had that, and this is when the outfit returned, because Zach had done everything he possibly could. And called out for his boys, Brad and Ryan, to come out. They came out and the outfit were not far behind, just Dino and Murphy. Zach grabbed the belt, ready to smash Caleb while the referee was distracted. We're just lucky, I can't remember who the referees were for half these matches, so I just assume something's going wrong and shenanigans are afoot. It's Dennis. But we had Zach had the belt in his hands, and then Ted arrived from the toilets.
Yeah.
Don't know what he was doing. from the toilets. Grabbed the belt.
No, he wasn't. No, he didn't come through the toilets. There was doors behind us.
Oh, I just knew the toilets were to our right, and I thought that's where he came from.
No, there was doors behind us. I don't know where they led.
Oh, okay.
But there was doors behind us that he came to.
I'm accusing Ted of just hanging about in the toilets. So he came out, grabbed the belt off Dynamite. It was enough time for Dynamite to turn around into a big spear. Hell Ride, 1, 2, 3, big popular cheer choice decision. You were up on your feet quicker than
I don't think I was first on Saturday.
No,
but I wasn't last.
No, we were big standing ovation for Caleb.
Up before you.
I just take my time to get up. So it was amazing, excellent match, fantastic. Zach Dynamite is, every match he's had I've seen recently has just been fantastic. He's just so good. And Caleb is got this big emotive, everyone loves Caleb.
Yeah.
He's big sexy Caleb. That's what he's just, and he's so great with people afterwards. The only disappointment was he wasn't hanging about after the show with the belt. You wanted a picture with Caleb.
The belt, so take it to hijinks, Caleb.
Oh, you coming?
I might do.
Oh, okay. Ace. Wonderful. Looking forward to that. I like going to shows with you. So,
I love Halloween.
I know, you get to go in costume. Last year I went as Mickey Vago.
I know, and you left my leather jacket.
To be honest, most of it was left on the floor because it flaked that much.
It was malting, wasn't it?
I know. I still like the story of Caleb, Vago. I'm just thinking of Caleb. Vago was told before the show that someone had come dressed him and he thought it was a child and he came out and it was me. So
I'm not going dressed as Caleb, but I don't have the six pack.
We could get you a cape. Mm-hmm. Do the makeup. You'd have to get a beard.
I need to know. I need to know where that
iron. He's not giving away the secret, I asked.
Well, I need to know.
It's just, it's some sort of Asgardian concoction.
Well, him and Thor need to launch a makeup brand then.
Caleb by Caleb. Valhalla by Caleb. Oh, I thought that goes Halloween. I went as Vago last year. Should I go as now wrestling wrestler? Is that
don't just, give it away.
Is that just creepy?
People will steal your ideas. No. This isn't a podcast.
I could get myself a waistcoat.
This isn't a podcast chat. This is a chat not on air so that nobody can steal your idea.
Waistcoat. I've got a waistcoat. Yes, this is happening. I think I have a waistcoat. Anyway, so after that was the handicap match. Still unsure who had the handicap. Was Omar and Mr. WrestleZone unfortunately lost to Brian Tucker because Mr. WrestleZone ran away to chase Reece Dawkins out, and Omar was left on his own.
Egypt.
This was again ridiculously silly because.
It was. But it was fantastic.
My favourite thing happened, and I wanted it to happen so much, and I'm so glad I got to see it happen, was right at the start, Mr. WrestleZone got put into a sleeper hold, just dropped dead, and Tucker took off Mr. WrestleZone's mask and celebrated, but Mr. WrestleZone was wearing another mask underneath it. It was the favourite thing that I've seen, because I thought, I hope they do it at some point because it's so stupid, it's so funny. And they did it, and I was still a little bit drunk at that point. I was like, ah!
Yeah, happened, because it was so...
There were so much funny little bits though, because like Omar gave Mr. WrestleZone a microphone. Somehow, Mr. WrestleZone ended up donking Omar in the head with it.
Yeah.
It was just, whoever is Mr. WrestleZone, we don't know. We definitely know it's not Scotty Swift.
We don't know who it is.
There's been proof.
But. Omar's gonna get fed up.
That's why I think
it's coming. Whether it happens at Hijinks or Christmas Chaos, it's gonna happen at one of the big ones.
Yeah.
But it's coming. I can see them.
I can see Anarchy being Omar, Mr. WrestleZone.
Yeah.
Or Omar and whoever is Mr. WrestleZone.
And the reveal. I think if Omar, so this is what I think will happen. Whenever it is, Omar will unmask Mr. WrestleZone at the end of their match if Omar wins.
Mm.
If Omar loses, that won't happen.
Do you think it's going to be like mask versus WrestleZone career? So if Mr. WrestleZone wins, Omar has to leave? Or because that's kind of how this all kicked off with Scotty Swift having to retire,
yeah,
kind of thing, and all that kind of mirroring and all that stuff.
That's it. So
see.
It's very similar. But I think that's how it will happen. I don't think anybody else is going to get to unmask Mr. WrestleZone. I think it's going to be Omar.
There we go. It's a controversial take. So the ending was Brian Tucker, after the distraction, Mr. WrestleZone running away to chase Reece Dawkins. Brian Tucker grabbed the Book of Shakespeare, which I'm assuming has got a brick in it at this point.
And I think it's just a dictionary.
He's a dictionary. So Tucker hit Omar with it, and that's how the pinfall arose. And then after the match, as Mr. WrestleZone returned, Rhys Dawkins came in and smacked the back of Mr. WrestleZone's head with his cast.
Yeah.
So that was the... Oh, the other thing, were you disappointed to not get bye bye Scotty? Because Dawkins and Tucker came out to the Bill theme. We didn't get bye bye Scotty, oh, yeah. Scotty, bye bye.
I was a little bit disappointed, but to be honest with you, I didn't remember that was their theme tune. So,
it's fine. Okay. The main event.
You're making me sound like an a-hole. Because I don't remember things.
It's Thursday. I was surprised I was able to write so much about it. Because I thought, I'm not remembering any of this. And then I kind of looked through my photos. That's kind of how it helped me try to piece together. I just know, I was speaking to someone from the podcast recently, and pretty much I was saying, I don't remember, of my favourite matches, I couldn't tell you everything that happened, but I know how I felt.
Yeah.
And that's the bit that's most important to me now, is I know how I feel during these matches, and if I enjoy it, then they're my favourite kind of matches. Yeah?
Yeah.
Although I can tell you quite a lot from my actual favourite match, which is Edge versus Mick Foley with the Flaming Table. That's probably my favourite match of all time. Okay. So I can tell you quite a lot.
To live up to.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Get some fire wrestlers on. Get some. Don't get me started on wrestling tables. Anyway, main event time was Aspen versus Mickey Vago, which two guys leathering the absolute shit out of each other.
Just don't get me started. Fucking cheated.
He didn't cheat.
He did.
No, Dennis made the call. He made the pin.
He shouldn't have taken it.
Vago,
it wasn't a pin.
Vago had his foot on the rope.
Vago's leg was on the rope.
But he didn't cheat.
But he shouldn't have taken the win.
So that was controversy. As the pinfall was made, Vago put his foot on the rope. Afterwards, Mikey Innes came back out. First line, like, all the stuff has happened. We talked about the shenanigans. First time this happened. Mikey Innes came out and pointed out that the foot was on the ropes. Mr. P, the Vago said to restart it, or he took his shirt off. That's how much he wanted it to restart it. And then eventually, Mr. P announced that a rematch would happen at Halloween Hijinks. So we'll get Mickey Vago versus Aspen 2. So I'm defending him. He didn't cheat.
Aspen didn't deserve that win.
We're not having a falling out here. But I understand your point.
He didn't deserve the win.
But, yeah.
It's unfair to Aspen as well, because he looks like a cheater.
Okay, that's fine.
That's not
here's
a real win.
Here's me defending my man here. Yeah, you're right.
It's not a fair win for either party. It's not a good win.
Mm-hmm.
And he shouldn't. He should be enough of a team player. Mm-hmm. And I know that this is a singles match, but he should be enough of a sportsman to go, no, that's not a fair win. I don't want that win because it's not a fair win. It's not a fair...
Right.
It's not a proper pin. It's not a real win.
Restart the match.
Okay. Rematch the match. Whatever way he says it. But he should not have taken that win. In my opinion, it's dirty.
I think this is going to be a start of something, though. Because
whether
there was,
I don't care.
No, but I was saying the crowd was definitely more on Vago's side in that match, the whole time.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it seems to be like Aspen is getting really comprehensive wins. Like, he is battering folk, and he's beating all these favourites as well, like Caleb but Anarchy. And I think eventually, not myself, of course, because Aspen for life. But I think people, the wrestler fans, are going to be like, oh, this guy's beating all our other favourites. We're not liking this. We want to see our favourites win. And I think... I put in my review that Aspen's not changed anything since he came back.
No, you've talked about this in the car.
Yeah, he's not changed anything. He does some fist bumps. But he's not went out of his way to endear himself to the audience.
No.
They've just enjoyed seeing Aspen back.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't think it's going to take a lot for them to go boo, and he's just going to go, well, I haven't changed. It's like, was it the scorpion and the frog, whatever it is.
Yeah.
Like the scorpion still stings the frog and goes, oh, why did you? Because I'm a scorpion, that's what I did. That's what I do.
Yeah.
So I think it's going to be very interesting to see how it
goes. I see where you're coming. Yeah, mm-hmm. I get that. And I get that I maybe should be looking at the bigger picture. But for that show and for that win, mm-hmm. in that moment, that shouldn't have been a win. It should have been... It was a fair win. It's Dennis's fault. He called it.
There you go.
But, you know, a true sportsman, a fair sportsman, would have said, no, his leg was up there.
Mm-hmm.
That's not a real win.
Yeah. Okay. There we go. That's why I like the differing opinions. I get your point. I absolutely agree with your point. But yeah, my favourite one, so I didn't care. That's good.
I mean, an own goal still counts in a football match, so, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Still counts for the opposing team in a football match. But still, it shouldn't.
Is that the match? Well, other than obviously Caleb winning, was that the match that kind of had you going, maybe I'll see if I can go to hijinks?
Maybe.
Was that the one that, because you want to see the resolution Diego of this?
Deserves a resolution.
Mm-hmm.
A better resolution.
Either he needs to be defeated cleanly.
Yes.
Or win.
Yeah. A fair fight.
Okay. There we go. A little bit heated towards the end there, but it's fine. I like it. Like I say to you, other things, I've watched wrestling for that long now that I can be awfully jaded when it comes to opinion. I get in your opinion,
mm-hmm.
because you're this is all you watch when it comes to wrestling. You're not that fussed for the TV
stuff.
You'll go see it live and then. No. So cool. So that was it. Whole show. We went out drinking afterwards. We went to one Wetherspoons, felt incredibly old, and then went to an old man pub.
I have never felt my age so much as I did. We need to know, though, was Miles in the... What's it called?
Was it Justice Mill?
Justice Mill, because I swear I saw him. We need to know.
The only weird thing is, I don't think I'd recognise wrestlers outside of their gear in real life.
Yeah.
You know, I saw Crusher Crave once, but he was wearing a big black hoodie, and I thought, well, I was Crusher Crave.
That's right.
So I saw Ryan Richards in Inverness once, but I wasn't sure if it was him. We met eyes for a moment. You haven't seen Ryan Richards, the rest of that show I went to in Peterhead. But we met eyes just for a moment, and I was like...
But there's the boy that's in Elgin.
Oh, I met him, Brooks.
Yeah.
Who we see.
I don't know his ring name. Yeah. I know him as his... I know his real name.
All right, so, Geddes.
Well, I know I'm from Elgin. That's not fair.
Weird thing is, since I've never seen, Mayhem, before, and then ever since I've started the podcast, I've seen wrestle in Elgin more. Because he lives around the corner, pretty much.
He does, yeah.
I end up just seeing him.
Quite a lot.
Yeah, though. It's weird.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can't really miss him.
I do just know him from Elgin.
Yeah. So, overall, great show, really...
It was a good show.
There was a lot of things that kind of ended, but then it restarted the back half of the year for hijinks and probably on chaos.
To be honest with you, before Ted disappeared, there was going to be an outfit foundation thing anyway.
Mm-hmm.
This is just seems to have come back round now that Ted's back.
I think... Again, it's all stuff I've written down, so I apologise to anyone who's read it and then is listening to me spew the same stuff up again.
I don't read his reports.
You don't even listen to the podcast.
No, I don't.
So,
I don't need to listen to the podcast. You're right here.
I think the outfit needed someone to do their talking a lot of the time, and they had William and they had Alan for a bit, and now they've got Ted.
Mm-hmm.
Because you're just in your head, Murphy, 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 Murphy.
That's not fair.
I saw your face just going, do some talking, and you're going, Murphy, 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 Murphy. But they needed someone to do their talking, and Ted's a very good talker.
Yeah.
He's such a shit. Like, I bet, like, once this is all blown over, he's going to be very easy to hate.
With him.
Yeah, very easy to hate, but...
It's like Aspid coming back.
Mm-hmm.
We're still in the honeymoon phase.
Yeah. And then we'll remember, oh, Ted's an arsehole.
Yeah, it's like when you get back together with that ex that everybody warned you about.
Mm-hmm.
You know? Not that I've ever done that. But it's like, you know, you get back together with that ex that everybody warned you about, and you know that it's wrong, but you're in that little honeymoon period where I can change them. Everybody's impressed with impressing each other again, or trying to be on their best behaviour, and then at some point that mask will just slip.
If we cheer Ted enough, he'll be on our side always.
Oh yeah, but that's never gonna happen.
No, but for now, I'm enjoying the camaraderie me and Ted are having on Twitter. We seem to like each other for a little bit.
Seem to have an understanding.
Yes, and as much as I like the foundation, I like to see two big lads that are able to take them on at the same time.
Please stop making fun of his for his height, because you know your wife's about 2 inches shorter than him. So.
Okay.
It's.
Well. I don't think I made fun of his height particularly. I made fun of him for blocking me on Twitter. That was more my fun.
Okay.
But anyway. So that was the show. Great show. God, we spoke about it for 40 minutes. We're going
to... Yeah, we need to go.
Yeah, we're going
to
go. Because it's actually quite cool. I may take the dog out. So...
He said it. It's recorded.
She hasn't heard it. But that's it. Thank you for listening to this for the last 40 minutes of us speaking about the show.
Okay.
I spent too long in Aberdeen. It seems I'm speaking.
That's enough. Aberdeen. Just...
I'm going. So, okay. Up next is... we've got a couple of interviews coming up. The next show that I'll have a road trip episode on is Inverurie. I spoke to Blue Thunder very briefly after the show, and we're hopefully going to set up some interviews at Inverurie, which will be nice. And then after that will be Hijinks, which sounds like I'll be joined by my glamorous co-host, which I'm very much excited by. So it's going to be a lot of fun shows coming up, and hopefully enjoy the interviews we've got coming up as well. So this has been Billy
and Kelly.
Oh, there we go. And this has been SWN Podcast. Go check us out on socials. See ya.